ignorance taking place. They're not realizing that in 2014, in December 2014, following the death of Eric Garner, there were protests, counter protests by police and former police officers wearing t-shirts that said "I can breathe," which were trolling Eric Garner and trolling his family and trolling the athletes who were wearing "I can't breathe" t-shirts. So to give Mark Davis the benefit of the doubt, I was thinking, well, maybe he's not aware that that's what the I can breathe phrase comes from. But then I was thinking, you just can't be this ignorant. And now that you know, and now you see how insensitive it is, this is just another example of this battle. This is the reason why, in some ways, you have the players asserting themselves against ownership and why the players have to have some form of vigilance in a lot of ways, because they're not just countering what's happening out there. Sometimes they're countering their own employers.
Well, my response to that is I completely agree with Howard if that were the case. I was under the impression, I did not know, I didn't even look at this story. I just heard about it late last night, and somebody said that he wore the t-shirt as a result of the verdict. In other words, we can breathe now. You know, we got the guilty verdict that we were all looking for. Yeah. That's what was told to me. I'm saying if that was his intent, then I don't take offense to it to that degree. But if it's what you say, if I've misinterpreted that, and it's something along the lines of what you're saying, then there's every reason to be offended by him wearing that t-shirt, without question. I just didn't know. No. I didn't know anything about the story. Yeah.
Yeah, and I thought it was the same. I said, if you're giving him the benefit of the doubt, what he's really saying is, okay, we can exhale, but right. You have to know the backstory of what that phrase means.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, even if the intent was meant to be positive, it shows a lack of awareness, clearly. Go ahead, Max.
I was referring to that in the previous segment. I think it's important. If what you say, Howard, is true, and he's on the sly giving a wink to the opposition to "I can't breathe," that's unacceptable. But it was my impression.
No, I'm not saying that
what he was saying is, look, I'm showing some... Well, I'm just saying, if he's trying to show solidarity, even if it's clumsy or uninformed in certain ways or tone deaf, I think it's important that a lot of the cries from the opposition, from the forces of injustice, call people with social conscience the quote unquote woke mob. And it's important if you want to defang that, then you can't join that. In other words, it's one thing to direct ire toward people of bad will, but people of goodwill who maybe need to have a kind of a teaching or a learning moment and aren't fully aware of all the issues, I don't like the idea of directing the ire of the mob toward them. I much prefer the idea of educating and sensitizing and bringing them further into the fold.
Well, then he's educated now. He knows what the phrase means. If he doesn't know, if he's watching this, then he should know now. Take it down and change it to "We can breathe now, finally," or something like that. By being defiant like this, you just look like you don't care. And so you make it about you. Clearly, that phrase means something over the last 7 years of what's been taking place here. So now that you know, fix it. It's really not that complicated.
Yeah. Yeah, don't double down. I totally understand what you're saying. Howard Bryant, thank you so much. Always appreciate your time and perspective.
No, my pleasure. Thank you all.
All right. Minnesota Timberwolves star Karl Anthony Towns with this reaction: justice and accountability, things I never thought I would see. There's much more work to do, but this is an amazing start working toward the reform this country needs. We'll be right back.
Hopefully, this will...
Dan Graziano, the Bears are picking at number 20. What should they do?
Well, they should find their franchise quarterback of the future, but I'm not sure that from 20 they can get up to where they need to do that. So if one of the guys they like slides back into that 8, 9, 10 range, maybe they make a move. Of course, they'll be competing with Washington and others to do the same thing. But if they stay put at 20... You could see an offensive tackle or a wide receiver, but I think defense more likely. Keep an eye on Nick Bolton, the linebacker from Missouri, as a long-term play there.
Next up is Rob. Rob, what should the Panthers do at number 8?
They should stay at number 8. Go get somebody offensively, like an offensive tackle or a Kyle Pitts, somebody that could make a lot of plays for your offense, that helps out a new quarterback if Sam Darnold comes to a new city. The only way that team is going to improve is if number 1 offensively, they can go out there and be consistent and score points. So I think go out there, help your offense out, stay stay at number 8.
Kyle Pitts would be remarkable there. The tackle's more likely. RC, the former Steeler, what should the Steelers do in this draft?
Listen, you know, being at 24 is a weird position, but Tevin Jenkins, the offensive lineman from Oklahoma State, could be there. Jalen Mayfield from Michigan. And if you just can't resist, I guess you look at Najee Harris, but there are so many backs in this draft that you could get later on. Get protection, get you a mauler, get some physicality up front to not only protect Big Ben, but to become the running football team that we know brings championships to Sixburg.
Well, so let me sit on that one for a moment, RC, and sort of reshape the question here, which is to say that clearly the end of the Ben Roethlisberger era is coming soon, whether this is the final season or not. Do you believe they need to address the quarterback situation one way or another in this draft?
Greeny, you know, that's an interesting question. I mean, you brought up the fact that Mike Tomlin just signed an extension yesterday. And the fact that that could be the thing that holds them together, the duct tape or the glue, as Ben Roethlisberger leaves. Now, you've already went out and got Dwayne Haskins. If you feel like this is a guy that you can groom, someone who can sit behind Ben Roethlisberger and maybe mature off the field, and then you watch him mature on the field, maybe that's something you look at throughout the 2021 season. But if you're the Pittsburgh Steelers, you know you're not going to get one of the guys. But is it a Kyle Trask somewhere in the second round? Is it a Kellen Mond somewhere in the second to third round that you feel like you can get, have on the roster and continue to watch those guys grow? I believe Joshua Dobbs just re-signed with the Pittsburgh Steelers. And so even with all of those people there, do you truly have your quarterback of the future? And if you don't, can you do something to get him in this draft? That's what Kevin Colbert, the Pittsburgh Steelers GM, is going to have to weigh heavily and balance out on draft day.
It's interesting. I think sometimes we do overlook the fact that they have Haskins, who 2 years ago this week was a first-round pick in the NFL draft. So it's awfully quickly to have decided that there's just absolutely no hope there. That said, Dan Graziano, what are you hearing?
I think they probably will look to address quarterback at some point in the draft, but probably not early. RC's idea about offensive line help in the first round makes a ton of sense. When you look at the Steelers and their history, their center just retired. The center's not a real exciting first-round pick, but the Steelers really prioritize that position. The Steelers centers go to the Hall of Fame. When you look at their history, that position, it matters a lot.
Yes, they
people
do.
People want to put a running back there. If you're Pittsburgh, I think you see the center position is more important to the run game than the running back is. And so I wouldn't be surprised to see them go that way, or offensive tackle in the first round. Maybe think about finding that running back in the second or third. And then as the draft goes along, you know, do something kind of like they did with Mason Rudolph a few years ago. If they find a guy they like, Rudolph's in his last year of his contract, so they may be looking for another guy like that to kind of take a long-term flyer on.
There actually is a center in this draft who is talented enough to be a first-round pick, and that's Landon Dickerson from Alabama, who transferred from Florida State. But there's enormous injury history there, which I think will probably mean he drops out of round one. Rob Ninkovich, as you look at the Steelers, a team with a lot of needs, where would you go if you were in their shoes?
Well, what's the most important thing about protecting an older quarterback? And that's up front. That's having an offensive line that's solid to where that guy's not being hit. You know, you see what the Patriots have gone through with the transition. Tom Brady, in his last year with the Patriots, if he was on the turf too much, that was a problem for the team. So just like the Steelers, if Big Ben is under pressure, he's not getting out of the way. He's not going to avoid pressure by using his feet. So the most important thing for the Steelers is to shore up that offensive line to protect Big Ben, because he is a little bit older. We all know he's at the end of his career here. So the most important thing for the Steelers, keep him upright, keep him protected, because that goes a long way when it comes to confidence, when your quarterback knows, look, I'm not going to be hitting the turf a ton of times in this game here. Let me just evaluate what's open and make the best decision. So I would say number